When humans receive electrical stimulations to their fusiform face area, they report massive distortions in their visual perception. We set out to study this phenomenon in an organism where brain activity can be modified systematically. In this poster, I'll talk about how we used optogenetic methods to modify cortical activity and cause changes to reports of visual perception in rhesus macaque monkey.
Inferior temporal cortex is a brain region that is thought to support the recognition of complex features and objects. The response properties of neurons in IT cortex are well studied. These neurons preferentially fire to specific object features in classes of objects. What is not clear, however, is how these responses lead to visual perception of objects. To investigate this, we used optogenetic stimulation and a cortical activity detection task where a macaque monkey was trained to discriminate trials in which optogenetic stimulation occurred from trials in which it did not. The animal is head fixed and eye tracked. The animal accepts a trial by fixating on a central target. In half the trials, the animal is stimulated with a chronically implanted LED array in inferior temporal cortex over tissue expressing the excitatory opsin C1V1. The animal saccades down to identify a trial as one that contained a cortical stimulation, or up to identify that a trial did not. The animal is rewarded with a liquid reward when correct. The first question to answer was whether a macaque could detect the optogenetic stimulation at all. In previous non-human primate experiments, it has proven difficult to measurably change behavior from optogenetic stimulation or silencing. This is strange, considering similar experiments produce large behavioral responses in rodents, and when primate neurons expressing optogenetic constructs are stimulated, it is clear that the neurons are individually changing activity, but the animal's behavior does not measurably change. To maximize the size of any effect we might observe, we chose the highly sensitive detection task and used a novel LED stimulation array that considerably increases the size and power of optogenetic stimulation for the macaque's commensurately larger brain. In this chart, I will break trials from the present experiment into two types, ones with stimulations in them and ones with no stimulation. The y-axis is the percent of the trials that the animal reports that it was stimulated. If the animal is truly able to detect if it was stimulated, we expect it to report stimulation at a high rate on trials with stimulations, and at a low rate on trials with no stimulations. This is in fact exactly what we observe. The animal is correctly identifying trials with stimulations in them and rejecting trials without them. To control for the idea that the animal may be detecting something related to the LED activation in his cortex, but not the activation of opsins, perhaps a sound associated with the stimulation, heat, or even light coming into the back of the retina, we implanted a second stimulation array in the opposite hemisphere, but did not cause the tissue below it to express opsin. Trials using this control array were interleaved in the experiment, and the animal was rewarded for correctly identifying them as stimulations. If the animal is detecting some sort of artifact of the stimulation, we would expect that the animal reports he is stimulated on those trials as well. However, the animal very rarely reports stimulations on these types of trials, and the rate is indistinguishable from trials not containing any stimulations at all. From this, we can say that the macaque is reliably detecting the changing activity in its neurons in inferior temporal cortex. To understand if visual input interacts with the cortical stimulation, we modified the detection protocol to show different visual images during each trial. The animal is still rewarded exclusively for identifying whether the trial contained a cortical stimulation, but now there is an image on the screen. If visual input interacts with detectability of the cortical stimulation, we can infer that the cortical stimulation is creating a visual percept. In this chart, I plot D', or the subject's ability to discriminate trials with stimulation from trials without stimulation, on the y-axis, and each bar on the x-axis is a distinct image shown to the animal during the stimulation phase. So, for example, when the animal is looking at a picture of a wrench, it is much easier for it to detect a cortical stimulation than if he is looking at a picture of a daisy. Particularly interesting is the case with no image at all, which was consistently the most difficult condition, though if sufficient light power is applied, the animal can detect the stimulations. We tested this effect at different light intensities and found the distinction remains between objects. We were also interested in how the location of stimulation affects this detection profile. Would stimulating at a different location change which images are easy for the monkey to do the cortical stimulation task on? We tested this with two sites in IT cortex about 4 millimeters apart, and found that stimulation profiles are significantly correlated between sites, and when split in half and correlated with themselves, they are more correlated with themselves than they are at the other site. The surprising similarity could be attributed to light spread, or to underlying characteristics of the tissue. I'll finish by touching on the methods we used for this experiment. We used the viral vector AAV5 with the opsin C1V1 promoted by the CAMK2A promoter. To inject virus, we use an injector array developed by Mark Eldridge that considerably speeds up the injection surgery and allows us to infect a very large area easily. After allowing the virus to express for several weeks, in a second surgery, we return to the brain and under a specific wavelength of light, visually observe the fluorescent reporter which tags cells expressing opsins to verify expression. We then chronically implant an array of LEDs developed in collaboration with the DiCarlo group at MIT and BlackRock Microsystems. Compared to a typical optical fiber, the LED array does not require a chamber, can be up to 50 times more powerful, and affects a much larger area. With this amount of power so close to the cortex, it is critical to control the amount of waste heat generated. The LED array includes a thermocouple to measure board temperature. The orange and green lines on this chart are power levels used in the behavioral experiments on this poster. My point in mentioning this is that though there is a measurable temperature change with each stimulation, it is very small. So in conclusion, we find that the macaque can detect this optogenetically induced perturbation in IT cortex, and that the detection of these perturbations is influenced by visual input and upon the location of the stimulation. We also show a new method for using behavioral optogenetics in non-human primate. Going forward, we imagine that knowing the effect of cortical stimulation by the visual input could reveal the exact graphics of the induced perceptual distortions.